Continuing on Sufi Tariqat, the historical perspective of Sufism, there are three types of feelings. There are happy feelings, there are sad feelings, and also there are feelings that are neutral. Means certain feelings give you happiness, others bring sadness, and to some feelings you are neutral. However, the roots of these feelings are embedded in your body and mind. Feelings arise like waves and then dissolve by themselves. When waves of happiness, sorrow, or neutrality emerge, go to their roots. Instead of getting carried away by these feelings as they arise, try to understand their nature and the source from where these emerge. Whatever be the nature of the feeling, discover its origin. In the roots of all these feelings, you will find an unfathomable zero. This zero is like a vast blue horizon spread within. That is your inner space. That is, according to Sufis, the state of Ruh, Ruh ka maqam. Like a vast blue horizon, it spreads within and encompasses everything within. Continue to meditate and you will find the intensity of these waves getting less and less. And when these waves cease to arise, you will find the eternal lake of serenity. Only then you will become aware of your mistakes. You will realize that you have been considering all that is ephemeral. And such ignorance is the cause of all conflict and duality. Through meditation alone, you shall vanish all your ignorance. Verily, ignorance is not vanished through your worship, fast, rituals, offerings, and austerities. And unless ignorance vanishes, you will not experience the bliss of Surur. This comes through communion with the whole, or what Sufis call as God, and this forms the essential core of Sufi path. Sufi path evolved as mystical or psycho-spiritual dimension of Islam. Although it evolved out of Islam, it is no longer limited in its essence to the original source. In reality, Sufi is one who has left the path of philosophy and all other bondages and is now heading on a practical path to attain oneness with the whole. A Sufi practitioner is generally A practitioner of this tradition is generally known as Sufi, though some senior members of the tradition reserve this term for those practitioners who have attained the goal of Sufi tradition. There is another common denomination, and that lies in the word dervish, which is derived from Persian word dervish. Out of this came into existence Sufi dervish, dance as a Sufi technique of meditation. This was really associated with Rumi. In many parts of the Muslim world, a practitioner of this tradition is generally known as mutasawwir. The term indicates as a person who has received the initiation by an authorized spiritual master or sheikh. While Sufis says that Mutasawwif, as one who has arrived to the end of initiatic journey, this implies the final extinction in the supreme principle of non-duality. No more duality. Yet still some senior members of the tradition reserve this term for those practitioners who have attained the goal of Sufi tradition. Sufism is generally believed to have originated among Muslims near Basra in modern Iraq. There is a history of Sufism, Transoumia, dating from shortly after the time of Holy Prophet Hazrat Paigambar Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Almost all traditional Sufi orders trace their chain of transmission back to Holy Prophet via his cousin and son-in-law Imam Ali ibn Abu Talib, followed by Owais Gharani. There are 42 masters who have succeeded their previous teachers. Naqshbandi order, notable exception to this rule. It traces its origin to Sayyidina Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu. From their point of view, the esoteric teaching was given to those who had the capacity to contain the direct experiential genosis or inner communion of God. This was passed on from the master to disciple over the centuries. This is what Sufis call as Nisbat, or what Hindus call as Parampara. Some Orientalist scholars believe that Sufism was essentially the result of Islam evolving in a more mystical direction. Sufism in the early stages of development meant nothing but anteriorization of Islam. Some others view that it is from the Quran, constantly recited, meditated and experienced, that Sufism proceeded in its origin and its development. The great masters of Sufism dispersed throughout the Middle East, particularly in areas previously under some influence and control. This period was characterized by the practice of an apprentice called Murid, placing himself under the spiritual direction of the master called Sheikh, Pir or Murshid. The Chishti order was founded by Abu Ishaq Sami, who was Syrian, and who brought Sufism to the town of Chisht, which is now in Afghanistan, by Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti to India. It is the oldest known order. Hazrat Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu's shrine or dargah or the commune or monastery is in Ajmer, a city in Rajasthan. He is known as Garib Nawaz, the custodian of the poor. Poor not in money, but in his spirit and the love for Allah. People from all sects and religions flock at the dargah every day, and during a spiritual function which is known as Urs, the crowd becomes phenomenal. There was another female Sufi. Her name was Hazrat Babajan, who hailed from Afghanistan, came to India and lived in Pune. Her shrine is in Pune. She is believed to have given God realization to Meher Baba by kissing on third eye region. She herself was believed to be enlightened from a yogi in Himalaya. Both Babajan and Meher Baba lived in Pune, India, a city that has known to become a spiritual oasis because of Sufi mystic Osho and his commune. In early centuries of Islam, Sufism was not organized into particular circles or orders. However, as time went on, the teachings and personal example of Sufis living in the spiritually decreed code of life began to attract many groups of people. In the same way that various schools of Islamic law, which emerged in the early centuries after the Holy Prophet's passing away, were meant to define a clear path for the application of that law, so the Sufi order, which emerged during the same period, also intended to define a simple path for the practice of inner purification. In the same way that many great schools of Islamic law ceased to be propagated and accordingly ended, likewise, many great Sufi orders faced a similar situation. During the 9th century, more than 30 schools of Islamic order existed, but later on this number was reduced to 5 or 6. During the 12th century, you could not count the number of Sufi orders, particularly because there were so many, and partly because they were not yet defined as such. Most of the great spiritual masters and teachers of the Sufi order and schools of law did not expect that their teachings would be given a defined and often a rigid interpretation at a later stage after their death, or that the Sufi orders and schools of law would be named after them. However, the preservation of the Sufi orders was often partly a result of their physical isolation as well as the direction that mainstream Islam took. A noticeable trend within these Sufi orders is that many of them intermingled when strengthening each other, at the same time weakening each other. Most of the Sufi orders kept record of their lineage, that is, their chain of transmission of knowledge from master to master, which was often traced back to one of the Shiite spiritual leaders and accordingly back to Hazrat Imam Ali, to Prophet Hazrat Paighambar Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as a proof of their authenticity and authority. The only exception to this is the Naqshbandi Sufi order